Welcome all to tonight's meeting of our pensions committee, again at Birkenhead Town Hall, lovely to be here. We were commenting before about coming up the stairs, though you do have to take a breath out of the way, don't you? I do anyway. But there is a lift. I pretend to look at the war memorial, as if I know anything about it, you know. So welcome here tonight. We do have a couple of apologies. First of all, Councillor Brian Kenny, and also Councillor Nick Croft from Liverpool's not able to be with us tonight. Other than that, I'm not aware of any apologies. Can I just ask if there's any declarations of interest? Yes?
Nothing at all, as a survivor pensioner.
Okay, thank you. John?
Apart from my standing declaration as a member of the fund itself, I'm not sure if on my register of declarations I've got the fact that I'm a board member of Taurus, which is a subscriber. I'm not sure.
It's being noted though as we speak. And so George's wife's a member of the fund, as is mine. So, yeah. Okay, thank you. Welcome, come on in, please. Absolutely, please take. Yeah, come on in. I'm sorry, Tony.
Scheme member, Chair.
You're a scheme member. Pension envy, you call it, don't you? That's what I've got. Pension envy. So there you go. Well done. Okay. So thank you for those declarations. The second item on the agenda is as minutes of our last meeting for those who are in attendance.
Thanks, Chair. I was just wondering if under item two refers to the public presence at the last meeting, and there was a verbal agreement to have a follow-up meeting with the representatives from the divestment campaign. I was just wondering if you could briefly update the committee on where we're up to on that.
Yeah, I'm happy to do that. Yeah, so they did send me an email and copied Peter in, and Peter, well, we've responded by inviting them to set a date and come and visit pension officers in Liverpool. I'm aware of the fact that that's a daytime invitation, so if they're able to attend during the day, and we're going to give them a tour of the offices, of what the pension fund does, give them an insight, and then have a discussion about any items they've got. I'm aware, obviously, of what their agenda items are, so we'll ask officers to attend who might be able to answer any questions they have.
So that meeting is still to be arranged?
Still to be arranged, yeah. We're waiting for them to come back to us with a date.
Okay, thank you.
We've sent them the invitation. Other than that, are we happy to, anyone happy to read the minutes as correct? Who's moved them? Jeff, seconded, okay. That, you're right with that? Scary doors. Right. Okay, so our full agenda item 3 is an update on local government pension scheme, which is going to be presented to us by Yvonne.
This report updates members on the review of the ill health retirement provisions and the public sector exit payment rules. Section 2 notes that the remit of the review undertaken by the Scheme Advisory Board Administration Subcommittee to develop recommendations to simplify both the criteria and administration process for all ill health awards. The government statutory departments have been commissioned to consider any proposed changes. To remind members, the current structure is detailed in section 2.3 and outlines the criteria for ill health awards in that a member must have 2 years membership of the scheme and satisfy the two-step incapacity assessment undertaken by an independent doctor. Firstly, they must be permanently unfit to do their current job, and secondly, they must be immediately incapable of undertaking any gainful employment at all. The doctor must provide an opinion as to the time scales that the member will remain incapable of gainful employment to allow the employer to determine the appropriate tier of ill health award. There are 3 tiers. Tier 1 is where a member is permanently incapable of gainful employment, and in this situation, the pensioner's fully enhanced state pension age. Tier 2, if employment is possible after 3 years but before state pension age, the pension is enhanced at 25% of the accrual to state pension. 3 is where employment is possible within 3 years of leaving, and in these cases, a temporary pension without enhancement is payable for a maximum of up to 3 years. Section 2.4 to 2.7 raises awareness that the current three-tier system is complex, burdensome and inconsistent, and generates a high number of appeal cases with the Ombudsman. Consequently, a proposal to remove the third tier along with the gainful employment entitlement test was put forward to gather costings. This would incur an additional cost of 0.09% of pay, which would need to be met by either reducing enhancements or moving to a 5-year qualification period for enhancements. The new proposed structure is more straightforward to administer, and that a member who has at least 2 years membership and is perfectly capable of doing their own job will be entitled to immediate pension payable for life. If they also have at least 5 years membership, they will qualify for enhancement of at least 25% of the pension accrual to state pension age. Where they are classed as being incapable of any gainful employment, they'll receive full enhancement to state pension age. I will update the committee on the outcome of any decisions on this matter. The latter part of the report covers the report of the public sector exit payments and progress to date. Since writing the report, it's been recently announced that DCLG will issue consultations by the end of November on the exit payments and reforms of severance packages within the local government. The recommendation is members don't be called, but I'm happy to take questions. Thank you, Chair.
Are there any questions? Most of the matters contained have been coming forward over a period of time. Have we got any questions? I'm happy to note the report as it is.
Agreed.
Thank you. So, agenda item 4 is a pooling update which Peter Ward will present to us.
Yes, thank you, Chair. This report provides an update on pooling arrangements and also seeks in principle agreement for the appointment of 2 pension committee members to the Northern Pool Joint Committee, subject to approval by Council of the final governance arrangements. Under Section 2, set out the background to pooling. The report that I brought in July set one of the key milestones in that was the formal establishment of a joint committee ahead of the April 2018 deadline. Under Section 2.2, I reproduce in the report the original governance arrangements proposed in our July 2016 submission, which sets out the proposal for an oversight board consisting primarily of representatives of the participating funds pension committees. The legal structure is expected to be a joint committee. It runs through voting rights and the need for decisions to be either on a majority basis or unanimous depending on the nature of them. Then goes on to speak about the role of the pool board, which is principally oversight, but there would be some decisions around administrative matters. That section concludes with the shadow joint committee agreeing employee representation through the trade unions once formally established. So participation in the joint committee will be a key element of the fund's oversight of the pool and its operation. Considerable work remains to be done in terms of finalising the detail of governance arrangements and suitable terms of reference. And that's again highlighted under Section 3 that it's important that we'll ensure appropriate governance arrangements are put in place. The recommendations set out under Section 13 are that members agree in principle to the appointment of 2 pensions committee members to the Northern Pool Joint Committee, subject to approval by Council of the final governance arrangements, and that officers continue to work with the Joint Committee to finalise those governance arrangements. Thank you, Chair.
Okay, have we got any questions on that? Can I just comment on the fact that a tremendous amount of work has been put into this pool of arrangements, and at a recent pensions conference there was a presentation by a number of officers from around the country, and each of the pools is quite different, and it's the way that they're structured. I think ours is certainly the most cost-effective method of constructing a pool, and with our pensioners in mind, whereas some of the other pools are quite expensive, should we say. It remains to be seen whether they'll be able to meet the objectives set out by government to make savings and to look for opportunities to invest in infrastructure. The Northern Pool already does considerable investment in infrastructure, and I think the way that we're moving forward as a pool between the three pension funds, West Yorkshire, Manchester and ourselves, is certainly the most cost-effective way. And I think a lot of that is due to the way that the officers and members have worked well together, and I think it's a credit to the officers of the work that they've done. So I'd like to publicly thank Peter, those officers who've been involved in that. And so the recommendation there is that we have two members on a joint committee of nine, so two from each of the funds, and then three trade union appointed members of the committee. So that's what we're being asked to approve, and that we ask officers to continue to work towards the Northern Pools formation. So if we're happy to approve that. So investment performance, again by Peter.
Thank you, Chair. It's a short report just confirming the fund's performance to the 31st of March 2017. It confirms that the fund had a strong performance of over 21% against its benchmark, which was around 18%. Section 2.2 gives a bit of background to financial markets, and it concludes with a table setting out the performance of the fund over the medium term, over 1, 3, 5 years, and over those time periods the fund has performed well. Clearly in terms of financial implications, as the fund's performance improves and its funding position improves, it makes the ongoing stability of the fund more certain. So members are asked to note the report.
Okay, the figures in the report are very pleasing. You'll see how well that we've performed as a fund, not only in our own right, but against national benchmarks, and when we look at the averages of other funds. So again, it's to the credit of the officers on how hard they've worked, and I read a recent report how well we'd performed against private sector pension funds as well. So local authority pension funds are doing extremely well, and give us the opportunity to be almost 100%. So the security is certainly there for our members, our pensioners. So it's a credit to the fund and the officers of how well we've worked. So the recommendation is we note the report.
If you could add to the recommendation, then we congratulate the investment officers on the performance.
Absolutely, absolutely. All happy to agree with that, John.
Yes, sir.
Just to echo your sentiments, especially considering the opening line to paragraph 2.2, which I think is the most succinct explanation of the times we live in. Global geopolitical developments provided the most significant headwinds to investment markets over the last year.
Yeah.
We could all just turn the TV off and not watch the news and just consider that. It's so full of information stripped bare of all of the problems we face ourselves. It's interesting, though, that for the last 7 years we've been told local government pension funds are unaffordable,
yeah,
that people have to pay more, that they'll have to come back to pay more in the future, and here we are with the excellent work of the funds and its colleagues that have been able to get the funds into this really strong position.
Thanks for that. I totally agree with that. Okay, so thank you for that, John, George, and Jeff, for all the comments. So hopefully that'll be noted, and our thanks to the officers of the fund. So, thank you. So we'll move on. Agenda item 6. A bit of a technical item on the agenda here, brought about by European directives. So we still have to deal with some of them, and this is one of them that we still have to deal with. So, you may have questions about it, but there are a number of recommendations that go with it. And again, our officers have already done a tremendous amount of work in moving this agenda item forward. Peter.
Yes, thank you, Chair. There was a previous report on this topic to committee in January. This paper derives from some work that's been undertaken by the LGA, and Section 2 sets out some of the background and key issues, principally around the fact that from January next year, local authorities will be categorised by the Financial Conduct Authority as retail investors rather than professional investors as they are at the moment. And under Section 2.4 to 2.6, the paper sets out the implications that that would have for both Merseyside Pension Fund and local authority pension funds in general in not being able to invest in the wide range of assets that are needed to implement the diversified asset allocation that we have at the moment. In order to deal with this situation, the Scheme Advisory Board, the Local Government Association and DCLG have been working with the FCA to enable local authorities to elect up for professional client status in a slightly more streamlined way. There are four appendices to the report. Appendix 1 sets out the protections that are given up by moving from retail client status to professional status, and then Appendix 2 sets out a summary of the FCA's policy statement, and then a flowchart for the process is attached to Appendix 3, and a template letter that will be typical of the letter needing to be written by the fund to all its counterparties to enable it to elect up. So there are a number of recommendations to the report. Firstly, the Pensions Committee are asked to note the potential impact on investment strategy of becoming a retail client from January 2018. It also asks the committee to agree to the immediate commencement of applications for elected professional client status. It also asks the committee to take account of the protections that it will forego. And then finally, for the avoidance of doubt, approves delegation to the Director of Pensions in terms of the application process. I think in terms of background, it might be helpful to say this really arose from the fact that a number of Italian and French local authorities entered into some quite complicated financial transactions which proved to be costly, and the EU, in a sense, in a blanket way, has sought to put protections in place. It does affect the treasury management activities of local authorities as well as pension funds. But we believe if we take the opt up with immediate effect, we'll be able to continue with business as usual. But happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Peter. Any questions?
Yeah. Chair, just to note that at the recent pension conference that you and I, Chair, attended, there was a session devoted to this, and the recommendations in the report are very much in line with what we were told. And the message was, get on with it quickly, and make sure you give an authority to our officer to do so.
Yeah. And I think that highlights the benefits of going to the conferences, being involved, attending the sessions. And you're absolutely right. The LGA have done a tremendous amount of work, which our officers are following the recommendations. So, yeah, absolutely, Jeff. Any more comments? Otherwise, we're happy to note the report and its recommendations. So, item 7.
Thank you, Chair.
Thank you.
This report updates members on the duties and obligations arising out of the General Data Protection Regulations, which come into force on the 25th of May next year. These European regulations govern how personal data should be held and processed by all 28 member states. The changes are in response to how both globalisation and technology advances have changed how data are collected, stored, shared and transferred since the introduction of the Data Protection Act in 1998. In paragraph 2.2, members will note that the government announced in June that it was committed to implementing the regulations and retaining the new legislation following Brexit.
In fact, the new regulations do not mark a radical departure from the current data protection regime, as there is already a legal obligation on administering authorities to keep the personal data of scheme members secure and only for appropriate processing. However, I have summarised the key changes for the pension fund in section 2.4 of the report. Members will see that there are 8 key areas where the fund will need to update its existing policies and publish them openly and transparently to all its stakeholders. For example, the fund will provide an updated privacy notice to scheme members detailing how their data will be used, who is involved in processing their personal data, and the various rights that members have in respect of their data. In particular, the fund will need to be very clear in its member communications around areas where the fund cannot comply with a potential request. For instance, a person's request to complete erasure of data may not be possible because of the fund's overarching statutory duties to the scheme, HMRC and the pensions regulator. In paragraph 2.5, members will see that the current maximum fine for a serious breach of the Data Protection Act is £500,000. The new regulations will introduce from May next year a new upper limit of €20 million, or 4% of annual global turnover. This is, of course, aside from any adverse publicity and reputational damage for the offending organisations. As the fund utilises computer systems to hold and process scheme member records, the effective security and governance of these systems is fundamental to ensuring compliance with data protection. And this is particularly important as the fund makes its strategic move in conducting more of its business with scheme members via the internet. The online availability of personal information places the fund at an increased risk of cybercrime. As detailed in paragraph 2.8, World Council provides a computer network infrastructure for the fund, and I work closely as a matter of priority with my council colleagues in ensuring the security and availability of our systems, as well as the security of our members' information. Whilst there is considerable media focus on sophisticated cyber attacks, in reality, the majority of data breaches are as a consequence of organisations failing to implement robust physical controls, work practices, or failing to educate staff on data protection and data privacy. In paragraph 2.11, members will note that all fund staff undertake an annual e-learning course. The staff awareness of data protection is a significant part of ensuring ongoing compliance. Staff awareness of the appropriate handling of personal sensitive information is mentioned as a key mitigation control under paragraph 3.2 of the relevant risks section of this report. Finally, paragraphs 2.12 to 2.14 outline the partnership work the fund is doing in ensuring it meets the new duties and obligations ahead of May 2018. Chair, the recommendation is for members to note the report. Okay, it's my understanding, therefore, that although we are a separate organisation, Merseyside Pension Fund and World Council are the administering authority, we are heavily reliant upon World Council making sure that they do their. And as a member of the Audit and Risk Management Committee for World Council, I know it's taken extremely seriously by World Council. But so if there's a problem, it's the council who are fined, isn't it?
It is, because the Merseyside Pension Fund is not registered with the Information Commissioner as a data controller. We actually operate as the Metropolitan Borough Equivalent in that respect. So some of the colleagues that I work closely with are the Information Manager in over Legal and Democratic Services in making sure that we meet these, as well as the IT people that I mentioned within the report.
So are you satisfied that you're getting the level of support that you need from World Council and its officers?
I am. As a pension fund, we have different requirements, we have different consent, etc., in regards to what we actually do. So the way we're actually handling that is working with other pension funds and with the LGA and making sure that we actually handle that. I am actually a member of the Information Governance Delivery Group for World Council, so I'm able to see what we'll actually do as well as with the LGA.
So we're doing okay. We're doing all right.
Yes.
Any questions?
Just in terms of, do the pooling arrangements have any implications for cyber security? Is there any kind of crossover there that impacts on this kind of issue?
Not at this moment in time. We're not. There's no discussions in regards of sharing any resources in regards of IT resources, which would be, you know, subject to any kind of cyber crime. Certainly, also we're not dealing with any personal data in regards of the pooling as it stands now. So it's more just a general information governance in regards of pooling, as opposed to specifically to those aspects.
In my understanding, pensions are still paid for and administered by Greater Manchester, Merseyside and West Yorkshire. Pensions are paid out by the funds, but the assets will be pooled. Yeah. So there shouldn't be any conflict. But you'll let us know if there is.
If there is, if they become aware of any assets, you're looking for.
Okay, so I'm happy to note the recommendations in the report. Agenda item 8 is again to do with training, and once again, when we look at, you know, the MIFID and the responsibilities we have under MIFID and the need to be professional, I just stress as we look at training up the need for us to make sure that we as members of this committee take up any and all training opportunities that are presented towards us. So, Peter.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. We, members will be aware that we have signed up to the CIPRA Pensions Panel Knowledge and Skills Framework. At the last Governance and Risk Working Party, one of the items we discussed was the fact that there have been two principal developments. One was the establishment of local pension boards, and secondly, that the pension regulator has developed an LGPS-specific training toolbox. That was discussed, and the Working Party recommended that we revised the training policy to reflect that, and so the revised training policy is attached as an appendix to the report, and it recommends that those on the Pensions Committee undertake both the LGPS fundamentals training and undertake the online pension regulator toolkit training before other training is undertaken, to provide a foundation for both understanding of benefits and administration and investments. I think at the last committee guided some training on access to the online, but we're very happy to repeat that either individually or collectively if required. And so members are asked to approve the revised annex which is attached to the report.
Thank you for that. So, Guy, you're still available to help us if we get stuck.
Oh, sir.
I've still got my notes on my desk, actually, so I'm going to make sure that's completed very soon. So, just encourage everyone who can to participate in that. I know that Paula Lappin has already done her online training. Did she get a certificate for that?
Yes,
she would have done it.
So, if we don't get that done and finished, that'd be good.
This is for a reminder to be sent out via email.
Yeah.
Because I'm not that expert at keeping up to date with my email.
No, that would be good, John.
That's done enough.
Yeah, it's you know, I haven't finished it, but I've logged it in, so yeah, it's good. And certainly the 3-day events are very good. I know Tony's been to them. George, I think you've been in the past, haven't you? You've done them in the past, haven't you? Jeff, so you know, if you can get along with them. They're good, you can mix and match locations. So thank you for that, Peter. We're happy to approve the recommendations contained in the report. Agreed?
Agreed.
Okay, so Annual Employers Conference, which again is at Aintree Racecourse, coming up on Thursday, the 30th of November. Another day for our dad, have a jump number 9. I hope you haven't noticed this. So, sorry, Peter, the LAF conference at Bournemouth.
As always, bringing the report to committee to advise that the committee considers who should attend. Certainly previously there have been attendance by the chair and party spokespersons. There is a cost of attending. We get 2 free places through our LAF membership, but additional places will cost around £800. And travel costs are an additional expense that can be covered by the training budget that we have. The dates are the 6th to the 8th of December.
it's a very good event, and it's very specific, obviously, to local authorities. I think I'm chairing the session, involved in one of the sessions myself. So this year, as an executive member of LAF, which I'm happy to do for the fund. So it's usual that Jeff and myself would attend, and it's an honour, isn't it?
Yes.
So we're happy to note that with the recommendation that both myself and Jeff attend the conference on behalf of the fund.
Agreed.
Yeah. Thank you. Sorry, back to agenda item 10. Sorry. So we should carry on. So, members, I'd just like to really encourage, this is an excellent event, and you know, if you look forward to managing your diaries, you know, it's an entry race course, it's just for the morning, but if you've not attended one before, it's, you know, there's lots of presentations. Guy will be presenting at the conference on administration, and it opens your eyes actually to a lot of the work. Of course, we're able to meet with the employers, many of whom attend. There's a nice lunch provided, and also we have guest presenters at the event. But actually, it's the only event annually where we actually meet a large collection of our employers. So if you are able to attend, it's a very good morning. It's well worth attending. So I'd just like to encourage you to attend that event. And know the recommendations that are in the report for us to do so. Agreed?
Chair, I very much regret for the first time in many years I will not be able to attend, as I consulted my diary and I find I have a municipal deputy mayor or event.
It's a disgrace. Can that be noted, please? That it's
and Chair, perhaps because it's the 20th anniversary of the conference, I'll make a cake as well.
You'll be missed actually, Jeff, so thank you for that. So hopefully as many of the other members of the committee can attest. Thank you. Okay, agenda item 11 is the pension board minutes. Noting really, it's good that we're able to see what work our pension board does. And I know that they're very active, so we're happy to note those minutes. And agenda item 11. Agenda item 12 is systematic investing, which is Peter's going to do a presentation on this item for us.
Yes, the report is intended to provide members with an update on the progress we've made so far in the potential development of an internally managed equity portfolio. There is an exempt appendix to the report that provides additional information around performance. But in terms of background, under Section 2, we have been exploring options to increase the proportion of assets managed internally. We want to do that consistent with our long-term investment philosophy and with due regard to risk. The accompanying report provides some background information and some initial outcomes from the back testing, which have been encouraging, and there will be further information provided at the Investment Monitoring Working Party on Thursday. In terms of risks, we diversify the equity mandates that we have with regard to mandate size and style. We have had a factor-driven portfolio managed for us by an external manager since 2009, and clearly as we assess the appropriateness of increasing that, we have regard not only to mandate style and structure, but both to investment and operational risks, which are more considerable for internally managed portfolios. But I believe it's a sensible thing to do. The initial indications you have are very encouraging, and it enables us to make better use of some of the information systems that we're already operating in-house. So at this stage, it's an update. There's more work that we need to do. Members are asked to note the report, and we'll keep you informed of further, hopefully, positive developments. Thank you, Chair.
Sure. Thanks, Chair. I think it's a really good idea. I think it demonstrates some of the ways in which the fund can be quite innovative, and that's how we're at one of the reasons why we're at 100 or almost 100% funding coverage. And I've had previous queries addressed, which I'm grateful for, but I just wanted it on the record that questions have been asked, and you know, the committee is doing its job in terms of examining the scope of the project, in terms of the study in the past and going forward, and how much of the fund might be in that. And I appreciate that we're at a very early stage, so that information will follow.
Yeah, I think it's a very positive report that, you know, particularly encouraged that Manchester and West Yorkshire are pool partners are not doing this project, and that'll be something that we'll be able to bring to the table and share our expertise. It's really great that some of our perhaps junior members of staff are involved in this. They'll be able to bring them on and give them opportunity. So I think everything about it is really positive. So congratulations to Peter and the investment team who've brought this to the table today. Look forward to further reports. So happy to agree the recommendations.
Agreed.
Okay, thank you. So agenda item 13, is minutes of the Governance and Risk Working Party meeting. So we're happy to note those minutes. Okay, there are some exempt items. So it's recommended that in section 100A, 4 of the Local Government Act 1972, the public be excluded from the meeting during consideration of the following items of business on the ground that they involve the likely disclosure of exempt information as defined by the relevant paragraph of Part 1. Schedule 12A is amended to that Act. The public interest test has been applied and favours exclusion. So, can I thank our general public for attending tonight? Hopefully you've enjoyed and felt welcome, and we've certainly, it's been a pleasure to have you talking to me.